Okay, so there's a reason why it's not uncommon for audiophiles to use Steely Dan records to test the sound quality of new speakers. The band is among the most sonically sophisticated pop acts of the 20th and 21st century, not just in audio fidelity, but in the complexity of their jazz and blues-influenced songs. Today, I want to break down one of my favorite Steely Dan songs, Deacon Blues, to show you what goes into making one of these things. And we might as well back up and start at the intro, which I'll play again. So that is one of the most recognizable intros in Steely Dan's whole discography because it features a unique kind of chord that's become a defining feature of their music. It's called the Moo major chord, they called it that, a specific chord voicing that swaps a second degree note for a tonic note in a major chord. For example, if you take the C major chord C, G, C, E, and you switch the second C for a D note, you've made a C Moo major chord. And you can hear Moo majors all throughout Steely Dan's music, like in the first chorus of Black Cow, the chorus of Don't Take Me Alive, even right here in their first album on Fire in the Hole. I'd love to run out now. And it should be noted that even though Steely Dan squeezed the Moo major for all it's worth, this voicing has a history that goes all the way back to the 12th century. The first time it was ever used was in Perrotin the Great's Viderunt Omnes. Take a listen to the beautiful second syllable of Omnes right here. After these quintessential expressions of the Moo major chord, the song dives into the first verse, and we begin to hear the story of a suburban man in crisis, fantasizing about becoming an alcoholic saxophone player. This is the day of the expanding man. The instrumentation includes a Rhodes piano, a bass that sort of floats along carrying the rhythm, Larry Carlton steadily holding the melody on guitar, adding small frills, which are hardly noticeable, but extremely important in that they keep you from getting bored with the progression while complementing Fagan's vocals. You have an acoustic guitar in there too, and the great Bernard Purdy, one of the best groove drummers of all time.
It's quarters.
Call me a fool, you say it's a crazy scheme.
If you listen to Deacon Blues on great headphones or speakers, you hear just how good this music sounds. Every instrument has its own life. Each sound is thick and close up when it needs to be. To achieve this, Fagan and Becker were explicit in following the example of legendary jazz producer and engineer Rudy Van Gelder, whose work at Blue Note Records defined a generation of jazz music. Van Gelder was notoriously secretive about his techniques, but it's known that he had musicians play very close to the microphones to make his instruments sound warm and intimate. Anyone who's used microphones, like the one I'm recording this narration on right now, knows that every microphone has a different quality of sound. Steely Dan's producer Roger Nickel described his extensive microphone collection in an interview once, and the point is that the band experimented exhaustively to get just the right sound for each instrument and vocal.
So useless to ask me why, throw a kiss and say.
You can hear right there that when we enter the second verse of Deacon Blues, a horn section comes in composed by Tom Scott, who detailed in a Washington Post interview how he modeled his horns after Oliver Nelson's orchestral style, in which middle register horns slide against one another to create a thicker, dissonant sound. Fagan insisted Scott include nothing in the high end, and for this reason, when the bridge comes and the saxophone solo happens, personifying the main character of the song, it cuts through the mix like a lightning bolt. Because the saxophone solo is such an important part of the song, Fagan and Becker searched for the right player to embody this sound. One night, they turned on The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson and saw this. That's Pete Chrisleigh.
They played the tune,
learn to work a saxophone, play what I feel, drink scotch whiskey all night long, and die behind the wheel. And I thought they were talking about my lifestyle. So it was easy. I take one take.
The instrumentation on Deacon Blues is immaculate and complex, but I think the lyrics are just as important. Deacon Blues tells the story of a midlife crisis, a man living a safe life in suburbia, looking through the glass at gamblers and wild ramblers, seeing romance in the million lights of the city at night. He wants to be a saxophonist, drink scotch whiskey, and die behind the wheels. Deacon Blues is a song of existential desire, a desire, as Becker says, for one of those mythic forms of loserdom, an opposite to the routine middle register existence that stretches life to a thin film of small significance. Fagan and Becker have always been sardonic and wry songwriters. Their smooth, jazzy feel stands in direct, almost mocking opposition to the punk rock sound that was gaining popularity at the same time. There's always a detachment in their songs, an uncertainty about exactly who they're making fun of. For example, they came up with the name of the song, Deacon Blues, by recognizing how ridiculous it was to give sports teams majestic nicknames like University of Alabama's Crimson Tide. This mocking tone has turned a lot of people off to their music, but Deacon Blues, I think, contains a hidden earnestness. In the lead into the first chorus, the narrator says he's ready to cross that fine line, the line between his existence and the one he wants to have. The song suggests that he's tried before and failed, but the music plays these lines like he's taking a running head start, barreling toward a chorus that explodes into the fantasy fully realized.
I'll make it this time. I'm ready to cross that fine line. Learn to work the saxophone. I play just what I feel.
For this reason, I think you can look at Deacon Blues as a kind of literature. The story seems to be the central component here, with each element of the music filling out nuances in the main character's fantasy, to the point where it's unclear in the last verse whether the narrator has actually done it, or has just been caught up in the dream.
I cried when I wrote this song, sue me if I
I think listening to Steely Dan with some good headphones rewards close readings like this. The layers are all there for you to examine one by one, or simply enjoy in their combined expression. The quality is great, the composition is complex, and the lyrics are interesting and dense. For me, all of that adds up to a song that is gonna last.
They got a name for the winners in the world. I want a name.
Hey everybody, thanks for watching. I love Steely Dan, and I love this because I've never analyzed a song before, and I love trying new things. Special thanks to the Washington Post and to Howard Wright's work on the Moo major chord and Steely Dan. Such comprehensive stuff there from both those guys. I linked them below. I want to give them a special thanks. I want to tell you guys about a channel that I really love. It's called Wisecrack. You can see it right there. They do video essays like me, and we've been pushing to each other because I think if you like my stuff, you're definitely going to like theirs. They do Thug Notes, Earthling Cinema, 8-Bit Philosophy. Just really great, funny work. So click over there, watch one, subscribe. I know you guys are going to love it. I have to catch a plane right now to Pennsylvania because I'm about to give my first TED Talk. Excited and nervous, and I'll see you guys on the other side.